Hello.
Hi, everyone. We're back with a very, very extra setup and a very, very extra intro. Oh, that's me.
Yes, you.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to season two of Hot Pot Talks. My name is David Ng. I'm here with my dear friend and longtime creative partner, Jen Sunshine. You might know us as the co-founders and co-artistic directors of Love Intersections, a media arts collective that produces documentary films about QT BIPOCs in our community. We're also members of the Vancouver Artists Labor Union Cooperative, also known as VALU CO-OP. Before we begin, while we're live streaming this program, we are beaming this from the unceded and ancestral territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. And I also wanted, we wanted to highlight today the work of land defenders at Fairy Creek. There's a GoFundMe that organizers have put together to support the Indigenous land defenders, and our colleague Cameron is just dropping the GoFundMe link into the chat right now.
Hot Pot Talks is a weekly series live streaming to YouTube and Facebook every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Pacific time, where we have free-flowing conversations with artists, activists, chefs, performers, poets, community organizers about what it means to be an artist facing today's realities, what ethical responsibilities do we have as artists, all the while sharing our favorite hot pot ingredients. This season, we continue these conversations on topics ranging from anti-Asian racism, BIPOC futurity, Chinatown solidarity, diasporic food cultures, and interrogating the boundaries between everyday activism, fine art, and cultural work.
So why Hot Pot Talks? I know some folks have been tuning in from season one, but you know, we really wanted to start this episode and start the season grounding it in the origin story. And it's one of the reasons why we started, why we invited the guests that we did today. VALU CO-OP is located, our studio is located in the Lim Sai Hoar Khao Mok Association building in Chinatown. And you know, when we moved into the studio in Chinatown, the co-op had we had long conversations about the responsibilities or the accountability that we needed to think about when we're moving into an area that is right now the site of displacement and gentrification. And so I should also mention VALU CO-OP has a no profits, no surpluses, no kickbacks model. And so surpluses go back into hiring artists and also to our community projects working group. And so one of the first projects that we're doing, and I'm happy to also share that this project, Engaging Chinatown, has really evolved over the past year and really grown. We're doing a project with the elders of the Lim Association Board, where we'll be digitizing their archives and also creating some sort of public engagement with public art engagement with those some of those pieces. Yeah, and also just a shout out to those who came up to our fundraiser over the weekend. We held a fundraiser for the Lim Association and we raised almost $3,000. So,
when we think about these themes of nourishment and love, I do, as always, want to plug our limited edition tote bag, and they are available for purchase on valucoop.ca, and it's 25% off. Oh my God. Have you eaten today simply means I love you in BIPOC language, a simple question asked by so many of our parents, elders, and aunties everywhere, evoking a shared familial sense of understanding, of love, and of tenderness. And these feelings of unspoken care inspired Hot Pot Talks, where culture and community nourish our bodies and for our hearts too. Finally, I want to thank our incredible team, Cameron, who is our lead project coordinator, and Lemya, our social media coordinator, who helped make Hot Pot Talks a reality.
So we're thrilled to chat with our first guest, Jonny Sopotiuk, who has been a longtime friend of ours for almost a decade. And as I mentioned, yeah, we wanted to start season two by grounding it in our origin story and our community at Love Intersections and VALU CO-OP as well. And Jonny has been with us since the very beginning. In fact, Love Intersections was initially founded in a conversation with the three of us after many, many bottles of wine. So without further ado, welcome Jonny Sopotiuk.
Hey, hi, Jonny.
Hey. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Welcome.
Yeah, many bottles of wine. Yeah.
Well, why don't we start the conversation with, I mean, just start it light. Like, how did we all meet?
Well, listen, so how we all met starts first, how Jonny and I first met, and then we'll bring you on and finalize this trifecta, complete the trifecta. Jonny, you know, I hired you to be an out in schools facilitator almost 10 years ago. And at the time, you know what? I can share what my first impression of you was in the interview process. Okay. I remember turning to the other person that I was interviewing you with after we had finished and wrapped the interview. I put you on the top of my list. It's a yes, automatically. You were just so engaging, so charming, so charismatic, and also so articulate and knew the kinds of politics we were about to, you know, disseminate in like schools across British Columbia. You made such an impact. And so how we brought David into this circle, if you will. I remember driving to an out in schools presentation, and I brought both of you on, and David had just joined, like super fresh. And we did a presentation, I think it was at some like French school in Vancouver, high school. And then after the presentation ended, sorry?
It was in a French school in South Vancouver.
Yes, that is, your memory is immaculate. And I remember driving from the school, and I believe you were in the passenger seat and David was in the back seat. Yeah. And David was like shadowing our presentation or something. We had done a really good, solid workshop. So I'm driving us and I just kind of turn my head and I'm like, oh, David, where can I drop you off? And so by this point, we were like driving down Main Street. And I can't even remember what you said, David. You said some other location. But then as we're driving down a Main Street, you were like, oh, actually, can you drop me off at Flower Factory? Or was it, no, the Flower Shop?
It was the Flower Factory.
It was on the Main Street. And I was like, yeah.
What he had said in the car. He was like so quiet. I'm like, Factory, please.
As you can tell, these are a gift, but as you can tell, I'm obsessed with flowers.
You are obsessed with flowers. So you get out, and so I drop you off at Flower Factory, and then as soon as you like got out and closed the door, Jonny and I just like looked at each other, and we just immediately had this like moment. and Jonny was like, we like her.
She's great.
He's great.
Well, yeah. I remember like meeting the both of you too. And, you know, I had just come back, moved back to Vancouver. I was living in South Africa for 2 years, going to grad school. And part of my motivation for going into women's studies was actually a lot of the frustrations that I had with the misogyny within gay men communities. When I was pursuing grad school, and I knew it was very intentional when I came back to Vancouver, I was like, I really want to get back into a community where that is political and that we can, you know, do this intersectional work together. And yeah, I was very, that was probably why I was so quiet. I was like, I want to be friends with these people.
Well, it was similar for me because I, you know, I had moved to Vancouver like 2 years ago from Winnipeg, and and I was like intentionally, I mean, part of it was looking for work. I was going to art school, but I also wanted to connect in with the queer community, but, you know, not the more problematic parts of the queer community. I wanted to hang out with artists and queer folks and folks who are politically minded and community engaged. And yeah, I found that through the Queer Film Festival and out in schools. But I think a large part of that was through your leadership there, Jen. Like, you really cultivated the community that you wanted to see. And I think that had real impacts in the way we delivered that programming and education in the school.
Mm-hmm.
David.
What did we want to talk about?
It was a good first moment to like really, really connect in a moto car co-op.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was great.
Yeah.
And then you are also really, I think you were there at the conception of Love Intersections. I remember because David and I were, well, because we were sitting on the Vancouver School Board's Pride Advisory Committee. And then when the controversy happened because of the policy update, and promptly after that, I told David about that experience. And we were kind of theorizing and talking about what it means to be both queer and Chinese and the tensions. And I think you were in those meetings. Now, my memory is a little terrible. Because I do believe we had drank a couple of bottles of wine by that point.
It was four, I remember.
It was four? Okay. But you were really there, and you really saw us grow and evolve. And it's been like such an incredible journey just to see how you have also evolved, and now we're all working together at VALU co-op, which is just incredible.
And you know, I remember specifically, like, I think with the conversation that we wanted to have, and there was the meeting that really that was the genesis of Love Intersections. It was the tensions at the Vancouver School Board, but a lot of the sort of calling out cancel culture that was happening, and we were talking about solidarity building, like how can we actually do community building? You know, and I remember the conversation was around race, but it was also like, you know, it was also across barriers as well too. Mm-hmm.
I remember those conversations really, really clearly, because I think there was another thread of it. We were talking about the content that we were able to show in schools and how like a lot of media out there is so typecast and almost stereotypical, like, and it's highlighting the reactive problems that our communities have to go through, and just a lack of spaces and content that really like celebrate our uniqueness, our difference. I remember that conversation. I remember those many bottles of wine and saying like, why don't, like, you're both really talented artists. Like, why don't you start an organization that starts developing that content? You know, and I remember saying that on a whim. And then I was like, oh shoot, like I'm like a white dude. I don't get to hang out with that anymore. But like, you know, it was, I think the role of folks who are actively working as allies need to like step back and support. And I was really excited to do that for such a long time, and see you both really, for like a flower reference for David, like blossom into your artistic practices, and you know, tour your films around the world. And it's really been really exciting to see how much of an impact it has had on our community. And I say that our community in Vancouver, because I think we're all connected. Like my background isn't Chinese, I'm Ukrainian English, but you know, the Chinese community and Chinese diaspora is such an integral part of Vancouver's history and British Columbia's history. I mean, all of Canada across Turtle Island. And I think we all have a role to play in supporting that work.
You There's know, actually was, a lot yeah. of overlap between the Chinese kind of diaspora and the like you know, Ukrainian diaspora too. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, how you grew up, where you grew up, and your background?
Yeah, I mean, that's a long and complicated story. You know, I grew up in Winnipeg, Manitoba. It's Treaty 1 territory. And you know, in Manitoba, we're taught that we're all treaty people. We all have an obligation to uphold the treaties. And if we're being honest, our Indigenous friends and family are the ones that did uphold their end. And it's the Canadian government that hasn't held their end of the treaties. But I grew up in Winnipeg, and I grew up in a family of second and third generation Canadians. On my mom's side, we're English. And then we think Irish, Scottish, we're not really sure. My grandfather came from an orphanage, so we can't trace our family lines past that. And in English society, it's very patriarchal, and we don't, you know, why would we even care about where our grandmas and our mums come from? It blows my mind. So, you know, the lineages are stopped. So, you know, British Isles on that side. And on my dad's side, we're Ukrainian Romanian. And my Ukrainian ancestors had to flee the Ukraine. They came over to Canada to farm and wow. You know, access a better life and fleeing from war and conflict. And at the time, they were considered the undesirables of Europe. They were not considered to be white, Anglo-Saxon or Christian or whatever you call them. They weren't considered a part of whiteness as we know it today. So a huge part of their journey was assimilation into whiteness in Canada, and a loss of the heritage and the identity, and that was really put to a close when the communist purges started happening. Ukrainians have deep history of socialist and communist values. You know, take away the politics of the USSR, but we lost a lot of our really, really strong cultural organizations like the Ukrainian Labor Temple and Ukrainian labor groups because of communist purges. So, you know, a big part of my learning about my history and identity, it's been a process because a lot of it has been lost, both intentionally and unintentionally. And you know, it's been a journey over the past, I would say, decade.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, I've been thinking, Jen and I were talking about this earlier too, because, you know, there's a similar intention in my lineage as well, where, you know, I've been doing a lot of trying to trace my family history over the past few years. And there's the reaction that I sometimes get from families, like, wow, why though? You know, and I think underpinning that is like, you know, we left that, right? You know, for this better future, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah, and so I resonate with that a lot. And then also a lot of our, I think I shared this before too, but like a lot of our practices, Chinese, like traditional practices were considered pagan. So they were very selective. Although I, you know, now that I think of it, so like idol worship is a big one in my evangelical Christian upbringing that was sort of selective, in my opinion, selectively deciding what is idol worship, because so much, I mean, we would still bow at my relatives' grave sites, right? Mm-hmm. Is that not, anyway.
Is that not pagan? Yeah.
Is that not pagan? But, you know, there was selective reasons that certain practices were erased or held off, and some that were practiced as well. Mm. Yeah. Jonny, when we chatted with you before this interview, you had shared this story. We had asked you about comfort food. Because I think I said something like, I don't think I've ever had Ukrainian food in your life. You haven't had pierogies?
Pierogies. Like,
okay, of course.
What? What planet? I've never had pierogies.
But I want you to, shared a really lovely story about, I think it was, there was a warehouse, the warehouse that said people before profits.
And let him tell the story.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah,
I'm giving it away.
you know, like it's interesting because I've never really identified with like food culture. It's not like, it's just not who I am. So this like idea of like comfort food, you know, I had to really think about it, but it brought up one of, you know, a very early memory, growing up with my dad. So if you don't know Winnipeg, Winnipeg is a very divided city. It's a prairie city, very working class, immigrant, huge urban indigenous population. And the city has changed, but it hasn't changed that much. And so it's one of those typical cities where, you know, you go north of the tracks and that's considered the poor area. And my family grew up very, very middle class in the south end. So I when I was younger, I barely remember stories of the North End or experiences of the North End, other than my dad saying, you know, I grew up in the North End, and it was a really, really rough, neighborhood. You know, my dad had immigrant parents. They both worked two jobs. He babysat himself at six. Wow. Years old, and it was just, you know, that's a life of an immigrant family. Yeah. And so I remember one day my dad was taking us to the North End to go buy pierogies, and I was like, why are we going, like, we're driving an hour across the city from pierogies, like, dad, like, why can't we just go to the Safeway? And he's like, those are not pierogies. Mm-hmm. And there's this one bridge you drive over. It's the Arlington Bridge, and it goes over the rail yard. So it's like you go straight up and then you plateau and then you go straight down, and you're going down into the North End. And just as you go down, there's this big building. I still think it's there. I remember it very clearly. There's just like these white letters, and it says people before profits. And I remember thinking, like, what is, I at that time, I had no concept of what that meant. And so, you know, I asked my dad, and he shared the story of, like, socialism and the CCF and NDP, and, you know, how there's communities that put people first, and then there's communities that don't put people first. And we were going into an area that puts people first. And so, you know, we start snaking down all these back alleys, and we pull up to this, like, very nondescript warehouse. And I was like, okay, this is really odd. Dad gets us out. We go open the door. And I remember it, like, you know, I remember walking in, and it was like just this, like, gymnasium full of, like, these long row tables of, like, these old Ukrainian grandmas literally making pierogies. It was like,
oh wow,
pierogi factory. And honest to God, all there was like a deep freezer sitting beside the door. You popped it open, you grabbed your bag of pierogies, you handed the, like, head Ukrainian grandma pierogi maker, like, a couple 20s, and you were out the door with your pierogies for the month.
And wow.
It's very much this community space that I guess was some form of social enterprise to create jobs. And create communities. And the grandmas would just sit there all day talking about, you know, the weather and life at home and making pierogies for the community.
Yeah. When I was talking to Jen about this, it reminds me of, so right now it's usually the dragon boat season. And in my culture, we make these, it's called jong, which are these rice dumplings that are wrapped in bamboo leaves. And then you boil them, and then you can freeze them. But I have very vivid memories of my dad has four sisters. and my mom all sitting, you know, in a row, sort of like in a, what's it called? You know, when you all do one task, what's it called?
Oh, assembly line.
Assembly line, thank you. Sitting in an assembly line and all, like, just making the most amazing. And so this was one of my quarantine projects. Was last May or June, I tried to make them myself, like, over YouTube videos. My mom sent me a recipe and has taught me, but I needed a refresher. And let's just say it just did not turn out the way that I had hoped. It's a lot of work and a lot of technique to hold the rice in your hand and wrap it in this, like, in this triangle. So,
Jonny, do you have something like that in your family where you have a shared, something that you, like, pass down that you learn from your parents, or just something that is, like, familial that you do as a family in terms of sharing and food?
No, it's interesting because my mom was the cook at home. It was never really a big family a family get together. On my Ukrainian side, like, or I should say on my mom's side, like there wasn't that rich cultural like background of like, this is like our English staples. You know, I like my mom has the way she makes mashed potatoes and like carrots and for Thanksgiving and asparagus that like, I cannot eat mashed potatoes any other way than my mom made it. But on my dad's side, like, and this is where like the cultural pieces of Ukrainianness were lost. My dad wasn't close with his parents or my grandma. You know, she was around. She would come to Christmas and Thanksgiving dinner, but we didn't have that like shared cultural history of like over food making. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, that was in I shouldn't say intentionally lost, but it was lost in the assimilation to Canadianness. So like, although pierogies and cabbage rolls, which I hated as a kid, oh my God, they're so gross. But now there's a little Ukrainian bakery in New West that makes the absolute best pierogies and cabbage rolls. And I go to get them there, but it was never a part of like our family upbringing to cook together. Mm-hmm. So we don't have those same type of like shared stories, which I think is a real loss around assimilation.
Survival.
And like, yeah, that's where so much of like the culture and the stories is shared and passed down. And, you know, I sometimes wonder, my dad didn't talk about his growing up much. And so we respect that and didn't ask a lot of questions, but I really wonder as like with immigrant parents and a single mom for a long time, and she was working all the time. So when do you have time to cook for your kids and share stories of our culture when, you know, you're barely affording to put food on the table and cover costs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love cabbage rolls, by the way. And
me too. Well, we just love cabbage in general.
Yeah, but my friends always make fun of me because I grew up like we ate Chinese food every day. So like white people food was like exotic to us. Like it was like a treat. Like shepherd's pie was like, oh my God, this is so exciting, you know? Yeah, my mom makes a mean cabbage roll.
Well, it's interesting because growing up in the prairies, right? Like every town, my mom's side of the family was from Carberry, which is on the railroad. And every town had the Chinese restaurant, which goes by a different name in the prairies. And like, I remember like, to be honest, I remember more memories as a kid growing up going for Chinese food than having Ukrainian food.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Interesting.
I want to pivot a little bit because I do want to ask this, what your, like how you conceptualize value co-op.
Oh,
because
yeah.
I think there are just so many people who would be so curious about it because I actually distinctly remember you took me out for brunch. Like one December, I think this was in like 2018 December.
Yeah.
And you're like, and you had been planting this big idea and you had just, you do this. This is the thing I love about you, Jonny, is like, you just have this way with words and no one can help being like seduced by it. And I don't mean that in like a creepy, terrible way, but you just have very,
drawn
to it.
I like seduce.
So you had been, you know, sharing this with me, but you you kind of officially took me out to brunch to like, to give me the spiel, and I just remember sitting in the brunch in the restaurant, and I'm like hearing all of this, and I couldn't quite understand because there's so much like labor language that I wasn't familiar with, but you were also very accessible with your language. So I got it right away. And you were planting this idea with me. And then, and I just remember, cool, count me in. And the reason being is that I just trust you fully 100% because I trusted the relationship at the friendship that we had built for like 5 years up or 6-7 years already. And so by the time you had, you know, you were talking to me about value and this idea of yours, I was already like, well, I'm in because you're in, you know? So I really trusted that process and I really trusted you. Fast forward, like, you know, half a year later, and it was in 2019 where then we started Value Co-op, right? But then officially November, in 2020.
November.
Yeah.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time talking through model and the idea, for sure. Yeah, I remember that brunch very clearly. I also remember taking David out for Nuba to have a similar conversation.
And he's attentive.
And seducing.
I need two dinners.
I just needed a brunch, evidently. You had two dinners?
Yeah. No, David, I mean, look at that beautiful haircut. She needs to be wine and dine. But you know, it was a long time coming, but I'll rewind it a little bit, because Value Co-op came out of my experiences. I originally went to school to be a union organizer. I did labor studies and was working in healthcare and in post-secondary. And I felt very disconnected from my personal arts practice. You know, it was like a bit of imposter syndrome. I liked the work. It was very justice-based. But it didn't feel like I could be my full, true, authentic, queer, kind of eccentric self in those environments. And I had lots of conversations with art friends. I went to art school, saw so many artists struggling and struggling in isolation, abandoning their practice because they couldn't afford to make ends meet in Vancouver, and so many artists who, you know, had to abandon their principles to make it and to be successful. And there's this binary of like, you're either like, you're as an artist, you can be an independent artist or you can be a business person. And I really reject that binary. Like, you know, most artists I know don't go into it to make billions of dollars. We go into it because it's our passion, and we believe fundamentally that arts and culture can really change the fabric of society. So I wanted to have a conversations with people who I thought were doing really good work, who were friends, who I respected, and I was lucky to get a grant from the BC Arts Council to essentially explore social practice. And look at collectivity, cooperatives, and unions in the art sector. And that had me living between Vancouver and New York for a year. I got to study with a really incredible artist who was involved in the Silence Equals Death and Grand Fury collectives during the AIDS crisis in New York in the 80s, and who has continued with collective practice to this day. His name's Avram Finkelstein. Through those conversations, I had about 20 one-on-ones, a group emerged of artists who had the value set around community, around cooperation, around this idea that like resources aren't scarce. It's hoarding that provides a scarcity mindset.
Yeah.
And so we wanted to create, through those conversations, create a cooperative collective environment where we could build sustainable practices. Sustainable in the sense that it centered our individual but also collective labor. So we were taking care of each other and providing flexible income opportunities. I'm an artist, but first and foremost, I'm a community organizer. And you know, this is where I get nerdy, but the organizing practice I work with is called whole worker organizing. We organize based on worker needs. And the number one need that came out of those conversations was access to a flexible work environment. So it was for early career artists who were just coming out of school. You know, it was a well-paying living wage paying job that sustained their practice. And for emerging artists and early career artists, it was a space where they could go and get work and get community and get support. But when they got that first big artist grant or residency that required them to travel for 2 months or 3 months or a year, that they didn't have to worry about risking their livelihood and abandoning all of the secure they have to dive into their practice. And then for artists who are more established or working full time, it's really access to that community and resources. And what I found so beautiful about VALU is that, you know, the way we have built that cooperative and our union centers those values. So, you know, access to work being awarded to our members who actually need it, as opposed to this idea of who's been there the longest or who's had first access, you know, creating an environment that centers IDPOC, Indigenous, Black, people of color, in paid work opportunities and you know, paying for all of the emotional labor that you have to do for white folks, like all of these type of things, building an organization and building the foundations of that. It's been tough. It's been challenging, especially launching in the midst of a global pandemic, but it has been, it's really been a journey being, getting here. And it's been a collective process in building this really beautiful organization that is now starting to shift conversations and shift, arts and cultural practice, I would say, across North America. We have groups in Toronto and LA and New York and Wisconsin and Halifax who are really looking at the work we're doing and looking to implement similar models. And I really do think it is, we're providing, similar to the work you did with Love Intersections, we're providing an alternative for folks, artists and cultural practitioners who are looking to step out of this, you know, this idea of either you're working for a nonprofit in a really hierarchical structure, or you're working independently in your studio in almost total isolation.
Yeah, you know, I've been thinking about this a lot. Jen and I always joke, but also it's kind of serious. There's a bit of feedback.
Yeah, I'm here,
Benji.
Okay.
Is it John?
Is it me?
It might be. Oh, okay.
I'm muting Johnny for a second, and then, yeah.
Okay, no problem. Well, I've been thinking, Jen, so we always joke, but in all seriousness, we have, you know, I'm also just thinking about, you know, what is the disruption that VALU is doing, not just in terms of the art world, but in sort of the broader structural, systemic pieces of what is what barriers that artists bump up against. And one of the things Jen and I struggle with, because, you know, Jen, we were looking at artists that we really admire, and we just really are envious of what they're able to produce. And a lot of that is because, you know, Jen and I have a very in the film world, we're entirely project based. So we're producing work based on the deliverables of the project, but that means we have zero studio time. We're not studio artists, even though we might want to. You know, we've had moments of this possibility. For example, when we were able to spend, you know, a month putting together at the Sum Gallery our first visual art exhibit, that was an opportunity that I think probably maybe, Jen, the first opportunity we had to actually just sit and be artists, right? And really sit in that sort of what we wanted to do with our art and what criticality we wanted to do with mm-hmm. our art. And so I think, you know, Johnny, when you're describing the labor pieces of and the flexible employment pieces as well, there is, I think that's a really core thing that I've been thinking about, like having not just, you know, yes, it's about having the flexible living wage income that so that we have time to make art. But the time to make art part is, I think, often maybe in the ways that I was conceptualizing it in my head, it just makes it sound like, you know, what are you guys doing, right? Well, you know, artists need time to actually
conceptualize.
It's work and it's labor, right? And in most in wage labor environments, like, we sell our time, and that's often physical labor, and sometimes it's intellectual labor. And when it's intellectual labor, it's somehow paid more. But, you know, that's a whole another episode there. But you know, our arts practice, our labor is often in these objects, whether it's a sculpture, whether it's a drawing, whether it's a video. But that's time. That is a representation of our work. And you know, there's so many artists who see themselves as intellectuals, as a pushback towards, like, you know, it's this professionalization and upskilling, because artistic labor and cultural labor is not valued. So it's this shift to professionalization, which I really, really reject. But moving back to this, you know, it takes time, and that time and that passion and that studio, that space for thought and processing ideas. And, you know, when I'm in the studio, I work with materials. You know, this is a current piece I'm working on. It's all these all these, like, dressmaker's pins. And, you know, my process, my artwork is very, very obsessive, compulsive. It's about repetition. It's about labor. It's about work. It's about the materials. So I need time to work with those materials to really let the ideas and my own, you know, mental health struggles evolve through these pieces. But at the end of the day, for every artist, it's about time. And if we're not valuing our time, or not being given space to value our time and get compensated for our time, how are we going to create a really important art on an individual level or a collective level? And I really do truly believe that art and culture have the ability to change society, hopefully for the better. And so carving out these spaces where artists can get together, can share, share meals, share food, and share studio space, to build our practices, I think is so incredibly important.
Yeah. And sharing time. But on the subject of time, I've often wondered how you have the time, Jonny, because you seem to be involved in a million projects. And so I do want to ask, what other organizations, initiatives, projects are you currently involved in, and can you share some with us?
I mean, which ones should I talk about? I mean,
the fact that you have to ask that is an answer in and of itself.
Yeah, this is my struggle. My therapist talks to me about, like, maintaining balance and focus, and you know, I like to be involved. I like to be a part of community. And do this work. It's really what sustains me. So, you know, I work full time for IATSE 891 and helping, you know, workers in the film industry, artists and technicians, you know, get benefits and wage increases and protection on the job. So that takes up most of my time. But in my free time, I work with VALU Co-op and our new co-op, the Vancouver Sewing Labor Union Co-op. And then work as president of the Arts and Cultural Workers Union, and the excited, and more recently, I got involved with the Stand With Asians Coalition, doing organizing. I mean, really all I was doing was connecting labor unions in, because it's such an important organization and movement right now. I think the initiative I'm really excited about right now is we're launching a new nonprofit union cooperative developer called the UCI, the Union Cooperative Initiative, that is very much connected to VALU Co-op. But it really is about taking the lessons we've learned at VALU and you know, the structure we've built, and allowing workers in other industries to take control of their work and build their own collective workplaces. And I really do see the long-term potential in the Lower Mainland in Vancouver, but across BC and Canada to really create those alternatives where workers have control over their own destiny.
Mm-hmm. Super cool.
Yeah. So I mean, I keep busy. I try and take Saturdays to just like hang out in the backyard with my new dog, and you know, like, and maintain that balance because it's so important. And anyone who works with me knows when I'm stressed, I'm not the easiest to work with. So you know,
no,
trying to like
not.
Lower the stress levels. but you know, it's like right now, I think we've built some really exciting things that are not yet fully sustainable. And so, mm-hmm. You know, you have to show up and do the work. And if you're not willing to, then you need to step back. And
we did have a very tough year, you know, not to, we started in March of 2020, like I think VALU CO-OP launched officially March 2020. And so,
oh my God, and terrible timing.
Terrible timing.
Well, especially when your business model is built on person-to-person engagement.
Yeah, conferences.
We had like a 60-page business plan that, you know, Kat really put together and we all collectively worked on. And in this business plan, and I guess for folks who don't know, you know, VALU CO-OP is a for-profit entity with what David said, no surpluses, no kickbacks, no dividends, no investments. All of the money made through VALU goes back into the community. But on the books, it's for-profit. And we did that intentionally so we could eat up business development funding and all the what I think are ridiculous and gross public subsidies to corporations. And now they're going to support a really important community arts project and union project. So yay for us. You know, we built this business plan and in this business plan in our threats and opportunity or in our threats section, we didn't really think about a global pandemic.
We didn't?
No. I should pull that back up because I haven't looked at that since the pandemic.
Some feedback for Van City.
Yeah, right. We love Van City. They give us a lot of money and a lot of support. Thank you, Van City Credit Union. If you don't bank with your local credit union, you should. But, you know, we like the pandemic was tough because we built a co-op that provides merchandise and campaign materials for person-to-person campaigns or conventions. And so overnight with the pandemic, we lost about $100,000 in developing business opportunities. Mm-hmm. And in the context, in 2020, VALU CO-OP did about $100,000 in sales. So we had to collectively scale back, and that was tough and it was stressful. We had to take out more financing. Individuals within the co-op had to put in personal loans and time loans. In an ideal world, we wouldn't had to have go through that. But the strength of the co-op model of cooperatives meant that, you know, one, we've survived, and I think we're stronger because of it. Our co-op has grown. We're now up to like 36 members who are working through it. And we've only had two members take full step backs and move on to other projects. And if we were a small business, I imagine we would have closed our doors a couple months into the pandemic, but we've been able to survive. I don't think we're thriving yet, but I think we're close to being there. And you know, we, not one person in the co-op had to take on all of the weight of carrying VALU. We all took it on in different ways and proportional ways based on our ability. So it's really been cool and interesting to see how the co-op has grown and evolved through those struggles. And you know, with with a reopening around the corner, I'm excited to see what's on the next horizon, because, you know, we've had some really stellar months with the co-op in terms of sales. Like, I think one month we did $24,000 in sales, which, you know, for artists, that some of which are, their annual income is $24,000. Like, that's a lot of money we're putting back into wages and opportunities for our members and collaborators.
Yeah, I feel like there was, sorry, David, go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, on top of that too, you know, I think what it also says too is because we're also a very values first, you know, organization, and the fact that we've never compromised that, and the fact that the organizations that partner with us to you know, on projects, you know, and that we sell to, don't hate to use that language, but you know, that we sell to, and but we're doing it values first. That really also says something, I think, about the community and the solidarity that our partners and customers and whatnot have trust in us as well. And so those relationships, I think it's a testament to those community relationships too.
Yeah.
I think back to 2020 when I joined, and then eventually joining the board as well. Coming out of it, I just feel very lucky that, because I feel like so much happened and so much conflict as well, internal conflict, which I want to be clear is not a bad thing. I actually appreciate conflict, because then we're able to tease out through troubleshooting and putting our heads together to brainstorm and to problem solve together. Learning a lot from that process, and continue to learn from that process. But what I really appreciated from that, it feels like, wow, we actually survived that. So that's one. Two, I was really surprised at my own self and how my strengths were able to be, how my strengths were cultivated at Value Co-op based on where I was at in that moment. Because during the pandemic, I was really not myself. I felt super isolated, like everyone else. And I really lost my sense of confidence. And it was actually through value, like bit by bit, through, you know, conversation and through working together and actually collaborating in the middle of a pandemic where I started to gain like a bit of a sense back and myself back, to now today, where I'm like, okay, I feel like it's cliche to say I feel stronger, but I do feel stronger in the sense that we went through the entirety of last year together. It's wild.
Yeah, and I feel like, not to sound super cheesy, but I'm gonna sound super cheesy. I think things like the timing, despite how awful the pandemic has been, business-wise, but also just, you know, in general, that there's like the timing when values started. I'm just thinking just in terms of the connection between value, love, intersections, and sort of our the community projects working group, which is really Love Intersections, Value Co-op, Limb Association, really joint work. Like, all of that synergy happened at the right time too.
Yes. Because if I were working in any other organization, I would not have been able to be like, okay, where does that organization and value and love intersection, where did they fit? But it just, the way that we created this synergy, it felt so organic and natural. Like, it just locked and makes sense. It was a no-brainer.
Totally. It's really, you know, it's all, it happened intentionally, but also organically. And it's been, you know, the work we've done at Value has allowed other groups of artists in Vancouver to start to exert their collective and individual rights by joining the union we formed, the Arts and Cultural Workers Union with IATSE. And we just concluded our first round of bargaining with the Contemporary Art Gallery, and we saw an average 17% wage increase for those workers, the 10 of them, in the middle of a pandemic when things were shutting down, and some of those workers who were making poverty level wages are now making a living wage. It was a like 37% increase overnight. Wow. And that, you know, that happened at the Keg, the workers at Galerie Gachet, at Cineworks, at CARFAC BC have all organized into the union we've built because of the work and the articulation of our labor values that we've put out there in the community. And so it's, you know, we're this impact is already starting to have ripples. And I go back to your point, Jen, around like, yeah, it has been tough, right? Like there's been a lot of conflict within value. I think we get once a week, we get messages from artists and cultural workers across Canada and the US who are interested in forming co-ops. And the first thing I say is like, it's not utopian. It's a lot of work and you should anticipate conflict. And
yeah.
And that's a part of the reason why we built a co-op and we built a union. So that, you know, the co-op was looking out after the cooperative, our economic interests together, and the union was there to protect us as human beings, as people. And one of people I really respect who I'm working with through the union cooperative initiative, Kevin Millsap, we were asked in a meeting with a potential funder, you know, why do you need a union if it's a workers' co-op? And Kevin was like, co-ops are run by people.
Yeah.
And people have conflict. And sometimes we need that voice to support us and that advocate in our corner to help us through problems. And I think that's so incredibly important, both in like a, you know, we're a unionized co-op as an articulation of our political values. But at the end of the day, in a real practical sense, the union is there to support us as individual workers. And it's really been, I can't think of the word, but it's been really beautiful to see how this community has flourished and you know, supported each other through like one of the toughest times in society, toughest time individually as we, you know, shelter in place. And I can't wait to see what's next around the corner for your practices and our collective practice through VALU and the Arts and Cultural Workers Union.
You know, I was just also thinking, Jonny, when you were saying that, you know, when we were sort of tracing this timeline of when we originally met and started Love Intersections and you know, now working on VALU, you know, I really don't think, like, again, just going back to when VALU started at the right time too, like I don't think Jen and I would have been prepared to do that, this type of organizing work, if it wasn't for the six years prior of really learning not just the techniques of social practice, but also like the, like really, really sort of interrogating the VALU of, well, what is the city of Vancouver calling it now? Intangible arts practice, right? Which is what we do, right? Our form is not tangible. Yeah. It's not something we can't sell our, well, we can sell our facilitation skills, but you know, the actual the form is social, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of old white artists who've made a living off of selling intangible arts, but like, yeah, for sure, like it's, yeah. You know, like we could critique that for a long time. I'd be happy to, but yeah, you know, this idea of community and how do we VALU community and culture and space and people and connections and relationships, like these are not quantifiable in traditional like economic and labor terms. And it's nice to see that that funders and governments and arts councils and institutions are starting to shift to look at this as like, this is a form of arts practice, and it's a form of cultural practice. And it has as much, if not more value than that painting or that sculpture or that video. How do we measure that? How do we record that? And how do we support that?
Beautiful. We are almost out of time.
Oh my goodness.
I know we have about a minute. Jonny, is there anything you want to talk about? Any last minute words?
I mean, no, I feel like I've talked enough here and I want to get to the hot pot.
So tell me about, okay, so I think this, we haven't asked this, which is, what is your favorite hot pot ingredient and what is your hot pot origin story? And we'll kind of end on this note.
Yeah, I mean, you've asked this question when I've been in the room so many times, and I always like move around between like, am I going to say mushrooms because I really love mushrooms, or am I going to say fish balls because fish balls are amazing, or do I say noodle? Like, I'm so, I don't know. It's like hard for me to pick. I think I'm going to go fish balls. And my, like, you know, I always was aware of hot pot, but it was like one of those things where I was like, you know, the white guy from the burbs, and I was like, oh, I don't know how to eat this, or like, I don't want to ask the stupid question. And I was traveling with my ex, and we were in Taiwan and in Taipei, and literally like everywhere, it's like hot pot everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, let's go for hot pot. And it was funny because, like, you know, two white guys walking in Taipei, and we didn't even have to ask. They just told us everything to do. Literally guided us through the hot pot. Gave us the trays, and they're like, okay, you come here, and then you go here. And I was like,
oh, yeah.
So welcoming. It was wonderful. I didn't have to embarrass myself at all. And yeah, it was like, that was my first experience in Taipei. You know, just ended up landing there. It was Pride weekend, so it was like this perfect accident. And yeah, had hot pot and sea cucumber and tons of different seafood, and I've been in love with hot pot ever since.
Yay, music to my ears.
Well, thank you, Jonny. It was so nice to launch Hot Pot Talk Season 2 with you.
Yeah, I still, it's that imposter syndrome. I was like, are you sure you want me as your opening guest? But I'm very honored to join you, and I'm so grateful for all of the work you do in the community and with VALU and our beautiful friendship.
Aww. Thank you, Jonny.
All right, we'll see you soon.
You later.
Oh my God, love Jonny. Love him. It makes so much sense that he's our first guest for season
totally.
Two. Yeah. Why don't we announce next week's guests?
Yeah, so next week we have Dana Claxton and Paul Wong. We're gonna talk about their friendship and their history pushing the boundaries of art. Anything else we want to announce? We run all the way till August 18th, season 2. So stay tuned every Wednesday, 5 p.m. All right, see everyone next week.
Good night.